everyone. My name is Scott Mantz, and I'm your host for today's Half Hour With. I want to welcome our Emmy-nominated panelists for the exciting new series, Most Dangerous Game, which is streaming right now on Quibi. First, let's welcome creator, writer, and executive producer Nick Santora. Hi, Nick.
Hi, how are you?
And let's welcome lead actor and two-time Academy Award winner Christoph Waltz. Hello, Christoph.
Hello, good morning.
Well, before we get into the conversation, let's take a look at a clip from Most Dangerous Game.
If you want to consider this, there are rules, most important of which is once you commit, that's it. No timeouts, no do-overs. My clients want to make absolutely sure you know exactly what you're getting into. They want a fair hunt.
What gentlemen?
Don't assume they're men. Hunters can be men, women, black, white, butcher, baker, candlestick maker. Anyone you run into could be the last person you ever see. Next rule, game takes place in Detroit only. If you leave the city's confines, that's a violation, and then the game never ends. Continues until you're killed. Go to the cops, get yourself arrested. It's a violation. You tell anyone what's going on, it's a violation. It's just you and the five hunters we've lined up for this run. No ID, no cash, no help, just you on your own.
And the money part?
Good, that means you're intrigued. Top of the first hour, 50,000 is wired into your bank from an untraceable offshore account. Next hour, 100,000. Deposits increase 50 grand every hour until hour 20, which pays $1 million, and that increases by $1 million every hour after that, culminating in the final hour, which pays $5 million for a grand total of
$24.5 million.
Here's exactly why you'll be great at this game. Smart, athletic, you know the terrain better than the hunters. You can pull this off.
Wow. Well, first of all, I just want to congratulate you again on your Emmy nominations. Nick, what does the Emmy nomination mean to you, not just to acknowledge your work on the series, but also the exciting format that we see it played out on Quibi?
What it means for me as an indication of the hard work that a hundred some odd people came together to make a project, it means a lot. So many people work so hard on this project and every project that when you learn that people enjoyed it, that feels really good. With respect to this format, I think it's exciting that a brand new streaming format has gotten recognition for the hard work they've put in. The people at Quibi have been working so hard for years to bring this idea to fruition. I'm thrilled for them.
Yeah, Christoph, I want to ask, you know, when you first heard and came to you with the concept of Most Dangerous Game, but more importantly, with the format itself, what was your first take on how it was going to be seen and divided up into the shorter episodes like this?
How it's going to be seen is nothing that I can anticipate, so I don't even try. Because usually when you think, and now I expect people to say this, to see that, to feel, you know, the other, first indication that you're dead wrong. What's intriguing and interesting and fascinating about this, as Nick just said, new way of storytelling. It's a dramatic narrative form that hasn't been around before. And just when you think it cannot, you know, you won't see some exciting innovation, bam, there it is. And sure enough, you know, you can trust Jeffrey Katzenberg with it. And So what I'm driving at is it's not just what it is, which of course is the most important thing, but it's also where it's coming from. So if it comes from Nick Santora, if it comes from Jeffrey Katzenberg, you know, you don't have to muster too much excitement or get it from somewhere else. It's right there in front of you.
You know, between Most Dangerous Game and a whole bunch of new shows that I've been watching on Quibi, I have to say that the format really does, it's a groundbreaking experience and it's a trailblazing experience because you're getting to see and feel things that you don't get to see and feel anywhere else in terms of not just one plot twist or one surprise, but a lot of them. I mean, it really makes it more fast-paced, more breakneck. And what were the challenges there, Nick? And what was the fun of all that?
Well, the challenges were literally not having any time to waste. If you have somewhere between 7 to 10 minutes to tell a story, there can't be any fluff or buffer scenes. Every minute, every frame has to be interesting and has to count. That at the same time was the fun of it. Every 8 to 10 pages, I had to have a massive cliffhanger or a twist or a turn or a character beat that was interesting enough that would make people want to watch the next episode. And coming from, you know, cutting my teeth in network television, and especially on a show that I did for 4 years called Prison Break, we had to, every commercial break, have something big happen. And I kind of learned it there, but I feel like I really learned it on Quibi. I mean, 15 cliffhangers is a lot to come up with.
Christoph, when you first read the screenplay, what struck you about the screenplay? And then what struck you about actually filming? Was there any difference in the way that Most Dangerous Game was filmed, or was it filmed like a movie?
So what struck me reading it was exactly what Nick just described. I may add one thing. All of this bouncing the ball from one episode to the next does not mean you can overlook the overall arc that leads to the end of the sum total. And that takes us straight into shooting. It was shot like a movie. Mm-hmm. It was shot like a great movie because for an actor, you're never shooting in sequence anyway. So the pacing and the precise placing of the cliffhanger and the beats and the turns and the twists is editing and directing. You know, it's not really the actor's work.
Tell me about working with Phil Abraham, Nick, and how things really start to take shape, as it often does, in the editing.
Well, it's funny. I had hired Phil Abraham to direct an episode of a show I created years ago. I think the poster's behind me, Breakout Kings. And the entire cast said to me afterwards, "You got to bring this Phil guy back." And as a showrunner, you just make note of that. You make note of the directors that actors love to work with. And when his name came up as a possibility for this, I hadn't spoken to him or seen him in almost a decade. And we spoke, and as soon as I was talking to him, I knew this was the guy I wanted to work with. Phil Abraham is the definition of a professional and the definition of an artistic director. He's really a wonderful guy. I can say 100% he elevated, just like the actors did, elevated everything that I wrote. And that's why he's coming in to do season two of Most Dangerous Game, because he's phenomenal.
Well, you're cutting to the chase there, Nick. You are really cutting to the chase, especially with regards to one of the submitted questions from the fans. But I also want to get your take on working with Phil, Christoph, and the conversations that you and Liam had with Phil and Nick when things were getting started, when production was just getting started.
Look, that's a very indiscreet question, you know, the conversations that we had. they were all to the subject. They were all to the point. And now what Nick just said about Phil, I'm a snob, you see, and I kind of allowing myself the snobbery, because I tried to jump over the high bar myself. Conversations with Phil are on the highest artistic level that you could wish for. they're not just, you know, sort of mundane pedestrian things, you know, go from here to there. That takes care, you know, with a real director, all of that stuff takes care of itself. Once you get to what it is that you're after. And so with a script like that, a director like that, actors are safely and securely embedded. And if you think along those lines, you know, you can surf on the script.
Nick, how about working with Liam? I thought Liam was terrific in this.
Oh, look, Liam's a dream. That poor guy had to run and jump and climb and fall and punch and kick and get punched and be kicked. And he did it all with a smile. One of my favorite Liam moments was we were filming in the suburbs of Toronto, and slowly but surely a group of 12-year-old girls started to gather on the lawn across the street. And it was adorable. Their moms gave them their homework and they said, you can wait for Mr. Hemsworth, but you have to do your homework. And he came out and we were talking about something. And then he looked, and without any air of arrogance, only with the air of a nice, decent human being, said, I think they might be there for me. And he walked across the street and signed all of their homework. And he's just a delightful, you can tell when someone was raised in a nice family by nice parents. And that's Liam.
Oh, that's great to hear. How about you, Christoph? What was your experience working with Liam on this?
Well, you know, he's a young guy, and you expect, you know, the testosterone-driven buckish behavior. Not one bit. Not one bit. He is a concentrated, lovely, polite, respectful collaborator, and therefore enables you to be the same for him. So it's really, you know, whatever you set in motion, you earn back. And he's, I wouldn't say earned, he's, you know, immediately won me over, and I stand in front of him with my hat in my hand.
Nick, I want to ask, like, when it came to filming, how fast was the shoot, and was there anything that you wanted to include, you know, without getting too spoiler, that you just couldn't because you wanted to really sort of stay true to the format here?
The shoot was fast. A lot was packed into a single day. It was approximately, I want to say, 28 days or so. Did most of the days in Toronto, a few days in Detroit. Phil and the crew worked incredibly, incredibly fast. I am not a guy who spends a lot of time on set. I like to get right back and start working in post. And editing is my second favorite part of the process behind writing. But the time I was there, I was amazed at how fast they were all working. With respect to anything that didn't get to be in there, not really. I had to trim some stuff with respect to budget. There's one line I wanted in there that I was asked to cut, which was, there's a moment where something really dangerous happens and it's insane and it's crazy, and Liam Hemsworth barely gets onto a train. And then he looks at everyone on the train, where everyone just saw him almost get killed, and he just looks at everybody and says, F in Detroit, right? And Mr. Katzenberg, and this is why Mr. Katzenberg is a very smart multi-billionaire and I am not. Mm-hmm. He said, you know what, that might insult people from Detroit, and I want them to enjoy Quibi. Could you please lose that line? So that's the only thing in the whole movie that I didn't get to put in.
Christoph, in terms of shooting at a breakneck pace like this, you know, 28 days, what are the benefits of shooting quickly versus shooting something where you have the, I don't want to say luxury, but you have the benefit of doing takes over and over again or having a longer shoot?
There are no benefits. Absolutely. You kind of stretch to, as the saying goes, stretch to the cover. You do what you need to do. Look, it's as John Borman said, film is money into light. and the economics of a project are equally important to all the artistic aspects. One depends on the other. So if it's 28 days, it's 28 days. But, you know, an advantage over 35? Nah, not really.
You know, the episodes are like you said, I mean, obviously they're lean because they are divided up into these shorter episodes, short form content. But the benefit is, like I said at the top of the conversation, it is a unique experience. It is an exhilarating experience because it is so breakneck. But Nick, what were the challenges in the editing to keep it tight like that and to make every moment really, really count?
Yeah, editing of this was very unique because there were episodes where they just flew by, they played, they worked. I was cutting them just like I would cut any act of television before a commercial break, or even an act for a cable show where a perceived commercial break would be, but you know you needed a twist or something to happen story-wise. And you'd look at it and go, this is perfect. And then you say, oh, but it's 10 minutes and 11 seconds. And I have to go in and cut out 11 seconds in one frame. And, you know, Mr. Katzenberg was very clear to me. He said, listen, you're going to have a lot of creative freedom in the writing. You're going to have creative freedom in editing. I'm not going to get in your way. But if it comes in at 10 minutes, you better lose one frame. Everything has to be under 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. So I had my marching orders. So it was difficult. Luckily, I got to work with phenomenal editors, some of whom I've worked with on multiple shows before that I brought in on this, and they know how I like to cut. So I was getting stuff that was close to where it should be anyway. And when you have a director like Phil Abraham and a cast like we had, there's not much work to do in post. It's all there. Put the pieces together.
Well, that's got to be exhilarating too, to work in such a different medium, you know, one that is reinvigorating, I'm guessing.
It's weird being the guinea pig. You know, being like one of the first shows to come out, and you don't want to blow it for a new company. And I don't think we did. It's done very well for Quibi. I'm very happy that they've had success with it.
Christoph, when you said you were filming it, felt like you were filming a film, and it wasn't any different in the filming part. But when you finally saw the finished product for the first time, what struck you about it? What was the first thing that hit you? What was your reaction to it?
How precisely it was executed, what was written so brilliantly. So it was not far away from what I envisioned when I read it. And that, you know, that's along the lines what Nick just said about Phil. It was, you know, I read it, I felt it during the shoot, and I saw it in the, you know, after you've done it for a while, you kind of develop a sense of what it could be. I mean, there are always surprises, but in that respect, I hate to call it such, but it was no surprise at all.
Oh, well, that's a good thing.
Yeah.
You know, Nick and both of, well, this is really for both of you. When you, like Nick, worked on the screenplay and then you got your cast, like what made Liam so perfect and what made Christoph so perfect as Miles? Like, made this just your dream cast?
It really is a dream cast. I'm still shocked that we got this cast. I never in a million years could I have hoped for this. And with respect to Liam, like I said earlier, Liam is he's a nice boy from a nice family. He's an everyman. And his character was an everyman who got sucked up into something, and you needed to be able to relate to him. And you know, he pulled it off so easily that it was kind of astounding. As for Mr. Waltz, for the nicest guy on the planet, he plays evil so well. I don't know how he does that, but that's acting. And he also brings in layers in characters that I don't think any other actor can pull off, because he's playing a man who's involved in organizing a hunt of a human being. and multiple human beings over the years, and you still like him. And you even see some vulnerability and decency in that character. So I was over the moon when I found out that Mr. Waltz was going to do this role. And when I heard that they were sending him the script, I said, okay, great. That's a waste of time. There's no way he'll ever do this. Because I just know he's an actor who has every opportunity to do everything in the world, and rightfully so. So I'm still over the moon. I can't believe he's on this thing now.
I can't either.
You're very kind, Nick. Thank you very much. I'm not flattered. I'm honored. Thank you.
Well, Christoph, Nick said, I don't know how he does it. So how do you do it? How do you play a character who is inherently doing something kind of evil here, but that you do like, that is irresistible, charming, that you're kind of talked me into doing something like this, maybe. But how do you sort of do it? I don't know.
You really expect me to tell you?
No, I don't. That's acting. But with regards to, you know, when you get a screenplay like this and you work with Nick, you work with Phil, you work with Liam, how do you further develop your character, or do you just sort of stick to what's already written and just go with it?
You know, that depends on the script. In this case, I stuck with what was written. Apart from the fact that is really what the job description is, you know, you do what is written. But that also means you're exposed to what it's written. You're dependent, and you have to rely on what it's written, because it is my conviction you cannot play what's not written. So that it's plenty to do, trust me.
Well, we have a couple of questions that were submitted, and Nick, you kind of touched on one of them at the top of the conversation. So without giving too much away, without giving anything away, because I don't want to spoil anything, you mentioned season two. Can you talk a little more about that? Because my question was, will we see Miles again? But it sounds like maybe we will.
Yes, I'm sorry for blowing the surprise, but yes, there will be a season two. And Miles, it's very Miles heavy, because listen, this is really the story of Miles. We have hunters that come in and out. But ideally, over multiple seasons, we're going to get to see this character evolve and change and see the running. It's pressure-filled to be hunted in this game. It might be even more pressure-filled to be the orchestrator of this game. We're already prepping it and trying to figure things out. And I was just talking with Phil Abraham yesterday, and we're moving ahead.
How about for you, Christoph, to play Miles again? How excited are you to further develop that character and sort of get it a little deeper behind the character?
I don't develop anything. That's, that's Nick. I just, as I said, I like to do what there is. I know there is a school of thought that says actors should interfere, and then they should be writers.
Nick, I if you can answer this question, that'd be awesome. If you can't, totally understand. Any hints about who might be on the run for season two?
I can't say the actor yet, because it is yet to be cast, but I can say that the character you will feel for this character, you will root for this character, just like you did for Liam in season one.
Well, the last question submitted here was, if you were in this situation and Miles kind of talked you into this, would you play the game? I'm going to ask Christoph. I'm going to ask you first.
I'd like to see that conversation. Me trying to convince myself. I doubt that I would succeed.
Well, thank you both so very much for this great conversation on Half Hour With. Once again, my name is Scott Mantz, and Most Dangerous Game is streaming right now on Quibi. Christoph and Nick, thank you so much.